The following program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.
Welcome to the Litchfield Historical Society's Art Show here at Griffin Memorial School. I'm John Latcher along with cameraman Anthony DeMambro. Please sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Here at the Art Show, the Historical Society, and we have the unveiling, which is the centerpiece of this event. It's the Cliffs at Canyon Junction. We have some members here of the Historical Society here joining us. Steve, would you please introduce members?
I'm Stephen Calawarren, I'm the president of the Society, and this is Gail Berenger, and she was chairman of the Art Show Committee.
Hi, Gail.
Hi, nice to meet you.
This is Kimberly Queenan, and she was co-chairman of the Art Show Committee, and she is also the donor of the Cliffs at Canyon Junction by Louisa McElwain, who grew up here in Litchfield. Her family lived just down the street from the school here at Brickyard Farm. Moved out to the Southwest, became a Southwestern artist, and she became quite accomplished and renowned. And we had been looking at her work for a number of years, and Gail had been in contact with family members seeing if possibly someone would like to donate a work to the Historical Society in town, since this is where Louisa grew up. But we hadn't had much of a response, and then Kim joined the Society this year, and she said, guess what, I would like to make a gift of one of Louisa's works to the Society, and we were quite astounded. And so she contacted Medicine Man Gallery in Santa Fe, which represented Louisa's estate and work. And this was the best painting that they had of her work, and it was the one that we favored the most, and so that is what Kim purchased and presented to the Society.
Now, Louisa McElwain was famous for her painting in the Southwest, is that correct?
Yes, and this is the Southwest.
Right. And she also, from what I understand, she introduced a lot of things like, you know, if there was a broken bottle on the ground or a piece of charred wood, she would include that in her painting.
Absolutely.
Is that correct?
Absolutely. And her work was plein air. It was all done outside, on site, nothing brought back to the studio. And Gail, who's an artist, can tell you more about her painting technique.
Okay.
Because she had a very bold style, as you can see from this painting.
And also, she was in a lot of publications, including the the Time Magazine, the Denver Post, as well as the Southwest Art Magazine. Is that correct?
That's absolutely true. Louisa's well known throughout the United States, and her works are actively collected by a lot of art collectors.
Well, great, Steve. Thanks a lot for showing us the portrait. Really,
oh, you're welcome, John.
Thank you. Let's talk to Gail here. Gail, let's talk about the painting technique.
We feel so fortunate to have this painting. As Dr. Calawar had said, we talked about it at our Historical Society meeting several times, and I reached out to the family, but the paintings were tied up in a gallery situation, and it's hard, if you know art, to get a painting from a gallery once the artist has died, and sadly, Louisa died in 2013. So we kind of lost hope that we were getting it, and then our new member, as Steve said, came along, And we are just incredulous over this. This plein air painting, it's a very different style. And you put paint on either with a palette knife or, as you had noted, with other pieces of glass or
right.
pieces of wood. And we have pictures of her with her canvas, some of them are really big, on the back of her pickup truck, and she's out there in the desert doing that kind of art. So
right.
we are thrilled, needless to say.
Great. Thank you, Gail, for talking to us. Kim? Thank you for your donation. I really appreciate it.
Oh, I'm glad I could do it.
Just for the town itself.
Yeah, I was
so
glad I could do it.
Why did you decide to go ahead and do this? Donate?
Well, I joined the society, and I heard them talking about an artist, and I didn't quite get the name right, and I went and searched for her online, and I came back, and I asked if this was the one they were talking about, and it was, and we just decided to go with it.
Great. Thank you for your generous gift. It's
I'm
great
glad
for the
to
town
do it.
Edgefield, as well as this historical society.
I'm glad to do it.
And one of the things to note about Louisa is her family's farm, Brickyard Farm, is where Steve Normanton has his grass-fed organic beef,
oh, okay.
and it's still owned by the McElwain Trust.
And also McElwain Drive is a connection with her.
That was the back of their farm, where that road came through, and they were very generous to the town, donating land for the school and so forth. Yes, and her grandfather was a famous shoe manufacturer, J.F. McElwain, headquartered in Nashua, and that employed many Litchfield and Nashua residents.
Well, great. Thanks. Thank you all for coming on. I really appreciate
You're welcome,
it.
John.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I paint outdoors. In all sorts of conditions, open to the impulse of changing light, wind, heat, cold, insects, and all forces of nature that bring life to my paintings. A painting for me is the sum of innumerable commitments to an idea, made in a dance to the tempo of the evolving day. It is a kind of captured choreography, an entire ballet, one can behold in a single gaze. Louisa McElwain. Here at the Art Show, we have another artist, John. John, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Well, thank you. It's fun to be back in Litchfield.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and about you, a little bit about your paintings.
Well, I grew up here in Litchfield, and I lived right across from the school where we are now.
Okay.
And I graduated from the eighth grade in 1958. And back in those days, all eight grades were in three rooms. We had a principal and two teachers. That was the entire faculty.
Right.
Back when I was a kid, 450 people lived in Litchfield.
Yep.
And if you were a kid, you worked at one of the local farms, whether it was Colby Farm or Campbell Farm or Redonis.
Yep.
So anyway, I started out as an artist as a kid here in Litchfield, and my neighbor Newell Carney was the local custodian here at the school.
Right.
And he critiqued my work, and he really got me started as an artist.
Did you always want to be an artist? Did you always have that desire to be an artist?
Yeah, I think from age five on, I decided that what I'd like to be most in this life is an artist.
Mm-hmm.
So I graduated from eighth grade in 58, went to Alvern High in Hudson, graduated in 62, and then I went to UNH and graduated in 66.
So you're a local guy. I
mean, I'm a local guy.
Okay, let's see some of your work here. I noticed that a lot of your work here is in regards to ships.
Yeah.
Is that a... is that something that you really are interested in painting, or...?
Yes. Actually, I left... teaching art in Sunapee, New London in June of 69. I went out to the West Coast to get a master's degree in art, and I did my master's project at the houseboat community in Sausalito. And I actually did my master's project on Chell Silverstein's houseboat, the winter of 71. So by living for most of the 70s on a houseboat, I absolutely loved looking out at reflections in the water. So
now tell us a little bit about this painting and how you come upon it.
All right. I just got back from my 24th Maine Lobster Festival up in Rockland, and this was a popular scene I did up in the Rockland area. The way I work is to take research photographs. This was with 35 millimeter film back back when I did the original. This is Victory Chimes, and it's the largest schooner that sails out of Rockland. Actually, it's the largest chartered schooner in the country. Okay. It was built in 1900. In this case, I wanted it off Owl's Head Light, so I've got it laid out like that. Sometimes when I'm taking my research photos, I'm also filming movement in the sea. So that scene is based actually on three bodies of water.
So you basically put three pictures together to make one.
Right. So I work in my gallery up in Georges Mills, New Hampshire, through a 5-inch magnifying glass. So I'm trying to be true to the body of three separate bodies of water. Yeah. And the idea is when I'm done, it's one seamless body of water with movement. The average original lately takes about 250 hours. Mm-hmm. And I would safely say that 70% of that time is right in the water. I just had my 50th reunion at the University of New Hampshire. I was the 100th anniversary class of 66, and they commissioned me to do a drawing of Thompson Hall. And I printed those, and I printed 125 of those, and they were handed out to my classmates from 66.
Nice.
I'm always in my scene somewhere, so if you look close.
Oh, is that right? Wow.
I was born on Leap Day, so technically I turned 18 on February 29th.
Right.
So at my 50th reunion, I announced to my classmates that I was probably the only 18-year-old showing up.
Right.
So I'm actually talking to my former 18-year-old self when I was a freshman in 62.
Isn't that something? Wow.
Now my son Cody is in the scene, yeah. And my other son Christopher is in the scene.
Oh, you put family in too?
They're both musicians that use my gallery as a recording studio with my brother James, who's a prolific songwriter. Here's a scene I did. I call this Christopher's Voyage.
Okay.
Back in 1970, I had a vision that someday I was going to have a son, and I was going to name him Christopher. And he was going to be Columbus in a scene I was planning. So back in 92, during the Columbus Regatta, the 500th anniversary, yeah. I filmed the three replicas coming into Newport, Rhode Island. In 86, my son Christopher was born. I named him Christopher, and he's Christopher Columbus in the scene.
Wow.
My other son, Cody, is a musician that plays in my gallery with Chris. So all the people on board are pretty much kids that record music in my gallery, and I'm up in the crow's nest.
So it looks like the word family means a lot to you in your painting.
It does. Yeah. So I call this, all the scenes I've done for years I call timeless, because I never put anything, anything modern doesn't get in my scenes. So in this case, I call this a timeless scene from 1492, crewed by my family and friends.
Well, they're beautiful paintings, John. Thank you so much for sharing them with us.
Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All right.
Thanks, John. Another artist that we have here at the art show is Caitlin. Caitlin, thanks for coming on. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Show us some of your photographs here.
Oh, this is done with spray paint.
Spray paint.
And
wow.
For the texture, it's newspaper. Lean over it and then crumpled up. And then I put a lid of something on for mm-hmm. the planet, and then sprayed black. And for the stars, it's just white paint. You spray it on your hand, and then you just flick it
okay.
at the tile.
What other photographs do you have over here, Caitlin? Show us.
And I have this one. Oh, this is newspaper too. Mm-hmm. And then
skyscrapers.
For the skyscrapers, I use a paint scraper,
mm-hmm.
and I just go to the left and then down.
Okay.
For all of them.
And this is done with spray paint, huh?
Uh-huh. And this is just on poster board, and those are done on ceramics.
Uh-huh. Very nice. Thanks, Caitlin, for showing us your work.
You're welcome.
One of the photographers that we have at the show is Matt. Matt, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you for your time here today.
Okay, tell us a little bit about your work here.
I enjoy doing a lot of variation in my subject. As you see here, I use electrical glass insulators that you usually see on top of telephone poles. And when you have the different colors that they create, and you light them a certain way, they can show up with some nice, quiet features that usually don't see when you're looking at them from far away.
Very interesting. What do we have over here, Matt?
This is one of my more graphic quality images that uses some striking lines with some soft background that has much more of a graphic element than that typical literal image that can be created. It's a lot of people will look at that one and see something different, think it means something different.
Yeah.
So that's some of that abstract work that you know everybody sees their own image.
What is it actually a picture of?
This is a metal grate that sits in the back of the Verizon Center in Manchester. And in the background here, you'll see some of the high-rise building that's in Manchester. And the light was a certain way one night and caught my eye. And as a photographer, you just have to stop and capture that image.
Here at the Historical Society's Art Show, we have Heidi Miller. She's a longtime teacher of the arts here at here in Litchfield, especially at the Griffin Memorial School. How long have you been teaching art here?
I've been at the Litchfield School District now for 35 years.
35 years, huh? Wow.
Started out with grades 1 through 8. So I was here for the building of the middle school. And when we built the middle school and opened it in 88, I was traveling. I did both schools. Okay. Continued to do that for about 8 years. Then they hired a part-time teacher.
Now you're also a member of the Historical Society.
Yes, I am. Yes.
What do you think of the event today?
Oh, this is terrific, you know, to bring the arts in town.
Yeah.
To have a nice cultural event like this. It's wonderful to have these local artists and some artists that are just from neighboring towns. And it's really nice that some of the students have come back to exhibit.
Some of the students have come back. Huh?
Yes.
Wow, that must be really
special. It's very special, yes. When I went to school here myself, I did not have an art teacher. But thankfully, my teachers let me dabble in everything on my own. And then finally, I took art in high school, Manchester Memorial High back then. And then I went to Plymouth State University and got my master's degree with Lesley University. But it's been a joy to teach art to the youngsters here in town. And I take a lot of pride in the fact that those who continue, and many of them have continued art and have taken it in
their, further, right?
Yes, they're taking it in college and they're pursuing it. And so it feels good because they started with me.
Right. So what gave you what inspired you to be an art teacher?
You know what? It was when I was in the fourth grade. My fourth grade teacher was Miss Welch, and it was actually room 10.
She remembers the room.
down in the old wing.
Yeah.
And Miss Welch set aside a couple of hours every Friday afternoon for some art. And we had this little art show, and this was pretty funny. I got a first prize blue ribbon on a drawing that I did of Joseph and Mary and the baby Jesus.
So there was no looking back after that, right?
And after that, right, my parents gave me all these art supplies, and the teachers let me create bulletin boards. Uh-huh. I illustrated all my reports. And made chalk murals for all the dances, and it just, that was my calling.
Well, this is a great event. It must be special to be a big part of it. I really appreciate
you
coming on.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. I'm here with Gail from the Historical Society. She has her own portraits here to show everybody. And Gail, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you for having me or speaking with me.
You're welcome. Talk to us a little bit about these are your own paintings, correct?
Yes, yeah. Well, I've only been doing watercolor since 2012.
Okay.
And when I retired, I said I want to do something artistic. Mm-hmm. I couldn't go to art school when I was young because there were no art schools here.
Right.
I did take lessons for 2 years, and the teacher that I had said, you draw first, drawing is important. So I draw.
So these are your drawings,
these
huh?
are my drawings,
okay.
And then what you do, because watercolor paper will smudge if you draw on the paper, you use tracing paper and you transfer your own drawing to the watercolor paper.
Nice.
And only then do you begin to paint.
Like this?
So this goes with that, and
this goes with that.
So it's kind of like a process.
Oh,
right?
It is.
It's beginning, like building a house from the foundation
out. Right, yeah. Right. Very time consuming, but I love it.
These are beautiful paintings.
Thank
you. You've got a great attention to detail. Can you talk to us
Thank you. Well, it takes quite a bit of time with watercolor because you use both dry brush and wet washes, and you need to let it dry in between
right,
so that it doesn't run all together.
Right.
And I just really enjoy it. This painting was in the Huffington Post, and it's my cat Oliver.
Okay.
I'd love to talk a little bit about the crows. It's kind of a folk art piece. And I had an elderly friend, Julia Ilk, who fed her three crows every day. And she called them Edgar, Alan, and Poe. And sadly, she's passed away. But in her memory, I said, I'm going to do a little folk art piece, again in watercolor. My niece, Ashlyn, photographed this owl in her woods by her house. She sent me the photo. And so then I said, I'm going to paint that for my niece.
Okay.
This tree is in my yard. And one of the big storms, I think it might have been 2006, knocked the tree in half. And so I call it the Century on Century Farm. It's where I live.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I can't leave this one out. This is my husband's favorite.
Okay, let's go over and take a look.
This is my husband's favorite. And our computer man, Hugh Mulligan, comes to the house when my husband screws up his computer. And he saw that I painted and he said, oh, would you paint my cats? So I painted his cats, and my husband thinks that that's the best cat painting. He calls me the cat lady.
Yeah, it's very, very beautiful.
And I don't know if you want the last
one. Yeah.
Marion Colby is a member of the society, and she's here today.
Mm-hmm.
And she sent me the photograph of her cat, and then I put my own tea kettle and cup in the painting. And again, it's watercolor. This was looser. You can see that I kind of splattered. I wanted a different effect.
So what gave you the inspiration to start to do the two paintings?
I just always wanted to be an artist.
Always wanted to do that.
And I call myself a beginner, but I'm going to keep at it.
Good for you.
Thank you
so much for showing these pictures.
Thank
I appreciate
you.
It. Here at the art show, we have the photographer, Howard Denton. Howard, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Nice to be here. It's a pleasure to be here.
Great. Tell us a little bit about your photographs, particularly this one right here.
Yeah. Well, as I said, I've been probably doing serious photography for probably 25 years.
25
now.
Years? Yeah.
Well, now that one there is in Nova Scotia. I did that so probably about 6 years ago in Nova Scotia. It's rather sad, actually. You see, it was a lovely old boat at one time, now it's just rotting away.
Mm-hmm.
But it makes an interesting subject, though.
Show us some other photographs that you have here for us.
Well, this one here, this was in Hollis, okay?
Hollis.
I did that in the winter several years ago. I just happened upon it, and it just really grabbed my eye, the fence, the trees.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been a good photograph for me to sell, too.
Okay, you have another one over here?
Yeah. This one here is the barn, which is part of the Wyeth House up in Thomas and Maine.
Very interesting.
Very famous Wyeth House. And that's the adjoining barn.
So why photography, Howard?
Why photography?
Yeah.
Well, I come from an artistic family, okay?
Okay.
They do paint, some of them do painting and so forth. I've never touched paints. Somehow the photography grabbed me a few years ago, and
you've been hooked ever since.
It's
huh?
just infected me.
right. Well, they're beautiful photographs. Thanks, Howard, for coming on. Really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for coming.
Hello.
All kinds of pictures here, huh?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
I work in colored pencil.
Colored pencil.
One of my mediums.
Okay.
And it's a very linear technique where you're drawing,
mm-hmm.
but then using all of that linear work, everything comes out looking like a solid form. Gives the illusion of roundness
mm-hmm.
and dimension.
Okay.
Through the use of shading and building up many layers of the pencil medium, which is sort of like painting with a one hair brush.
What gave you the inspiration to go ahead and try this out?
I've been drawing since I was about that big.
Okay.
So that I took classes when I was going through school, in high school, and I went on from there. I majored in interior and environmental design at Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, New York.
Yeah. So what are your favorites here out of all these pictures? Do you have a couple of favorite ones? Or
this particular piece here, I live in Keene, and this farm, when I moved to Keene about 20 years ago, was in the backyard behind the complex where I live. It's gone now, but I had taken many photographs of, in different seasons, of these farm buildings.
So what other ones do you?
Well, then besides doing some of the farms,
yeah,
my primary interest is in setting up still lifes,
okay,
which is a composed arrangement.
Well, they're all beautiful pictures, Liz. I really appreciate you showing to us and our viewers. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Here we have Tony. He's a photographer. Tony, thanks for coming on.
Tony, yep.
Tell us a little bit about your work.
Okay. A lot of my work is, this is here, a table for two. And this was made in Olachet Beach.
Pick it up and show it to our viewers. Tom.
Yep, this one right here, Olachet Beach. And that was a nice one because I did it early in the morning, like 6 o'clock in the morning, did that one. And then the other one is sea glass and shells, which I did this in my garage.
Uh-huh.
And that's a really a nice shot. This one here is in Olachet Beach.
Carousel, yeah.
Yeah, the carousel, it really came out nice, because a lot of times what I'm doing now, I'm trying to go black and white rather than color. And this one here, I was driving up a road, and this one here is in Buxton, Maine. And I saw it, I liked it, and it looks nice. And this one here is in McClutchin Farms, across the street from the stand.
Yeah.
And that was a nice photo.
This one over here, I can see myself sitting in one of those chairs.
You can.
Yeah.
You can.
Yeah.
Because I made sure I had the wine bottle.
Is that the whole idea?
Wine glasses,
it? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I didn't have the people, but anyway.
Should have been a photographer.
Yeah.
So what gave you the inspiration to be a photographer, Tony?
Oh, I was an electrician for 55 years.
Uh-huh.
And I took photos, but I wasn't really looking at the photos that much. Right. I just took them.
Yeah.
But when I retired at 65, then what happened was I still really started paying attention to what I was taking.
Yeah.
So it just isn't a picture to me anymore. It's just a piece of art.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I really enjoy what I do.
Well, thanks, Tony. One of the many people that we have here at the art show is Rich. Rich, thanks for coming on the program. Appreciate
it. Hey, no problem. Got to tell you a little story.
Okay.
You know where my wife and I live? Just across the street,
mm-hmm,
in the old house.
Yeah.
We have a patio out back.
Okay.
We like to go out there and eat dinner, particularly in the summer. So we go out there, and you generally stay out there till dusk, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there are two bats that come out almost every single night, and they fly around. You know how bats will.
Right, right.
They fly around, and we've gotten so used to them,
mm-hmm,
that we look for them now. And one of them is a big bat, and the other one is a little bat. Okay,
right.
Big and little.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
So, these bats, we've noticed there's no mosquitoes. There's no mosquitoes.
I knew, Rich, that you were leading to something, but go ahead.
There's no mosquitoes in our backyard.
Okay.
These two bats have to be the best mosquito-eating bats in the world.
Right.
Guess what?
What?
I've named them.
Get a name for him? Yeah.
Al. The big one's Al.
Al,
little one's John.
Well, thanks, Rich. Thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
All right, no problem.
One of the vendors that we have here is Gene. Gene, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Oh, I'm happy to be here.
Great. What do you have to offer here?
I have little signs that I make.
Okay.
Mostly to make people smile.
That's a good thing. Yeah.
I enjoy them. Every time I make them, I laugh at them.
So I see you have some sort of a cane here, huh?
Yep. I make these, I call them golfer canes.
Golfer canes?
Yep. They're made with golf clubs.
Yeah. So you just, yeah.
The hardest thing to do is to drill in here because you end up breaking so many bits because it's a very hard metal in some of them.
Right, right. So that's when did you come upon the idea of doing that?
Well, my husband and I used to do antique shows. We used to travel up and down the East Coast. Uh-huh. And in Florida, I saw a lot of these golf clubs, you know, around, and nobody ever bought any. So I said, gee, you got to do something with them. So I played around.
Right.
And I've been using this. I'm going in for a knee operation, and I'll tell you, they're really rugged.
Yeah.
They also make a good weapon.
Well, thanks, Gene. Thanks for coming on.
You're welcome.
One of the artists that we have here is from SEH Studios. It's Susan. Susan, thanks for coming on.
Hi. Thank you for having me.
Talk to us a little bit about what you have to offer here.
These small paintings are, well, number one, everything here is an oil painting.
Oil painting, okay.
And these little paintings on the front, they're actually painted directly on aluminum.
Oh, wow.
And these were all painted actually while I was sitting on the beach. So you will see sand encrusted inside of these paintings. These are just little, I try to have something for every price point. And so these are $20 and they're what I call minis. This is actually a scene of Rye, New Hampshire, and it's one of the marsh areas right along 1A there. I was there, I took the reference photo, saw it with my own eyes. But then I went back to the studio and recreated the scene to my own specifications. The scene above is actually of Londonderry, and it is the Max Orchards in the spring. The trees are flowering. Again, this was a studio piece. Took quite a while. Both of these pieces took quite a while because this smooth is a lot of glazing where I let the paint dry and then I go back in again and add another layer and add another layer. That's how you get that kind of fuzzy effect and the clouds in the background on this one. So this is a painting that I did in Agunquit, Maine. And this one as well, sitting on the beach. This is again down over in Agunquit near Perkins Cove. So the smaller ones because they can be finished quickly before the light changes.
Well, that one right there.
This one or
yeah.
This is a photo that I took, and I did that back. Actually, I didn't do that in the studio because I actually do a lot of painting demonstrations where I stand in front of a business or in this case, a particular gallery, and I do painting demonstrations. So I did that one over a couple of days while I was standing in front of a gallery using a reference photo that I had taken myself. I usually have in mind what I'm going to do, but with that said, I like to say I go where the paint takes me. If a certain bit of paint looks a certain way, the color, or maybe I really like the way that I skipped over it a little bit, and it left, for instance, on these clouds, these were done with a large brush really, really, really quickly, almost the last touch. Sometimes you just have to just let it go. And
so what gave you the inspiration to paint?
I have always painted. I painted as a child. I did many other things, but then I actually went to painting full-time 2 years ago.
Well, thanks, Susan. Thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much for having me.
Another of the numerous artists that we have here at the art show is Pam. Pam, thanks for coming on.
Oh, thank you for coming.
Tell us about what kind of work you do here.
I am making rugs by hooking wool. And in order to hook, you need your wool. And I've cut it. And this is called a wide cut. It's a size 8.
Are those the wool strips right there?
Yes.
All come in different. Tell us a little bit about the ones that you did over here in the background.
Oh, okay. The first one over here, this was my first rug. So
that was
it's
your first one? Yeah.
Yes, the schooner. So it's pretty simple. Mm-hmm. Trying to make movement in the water. You know, you just don't like flat hook it in the sky. It didn't take me too long to do. And that's a bit of a primitive pattern, using the wider cut of wool.
Okay, we have over here some mermaids, huh?
Yes, this one I just finished, so I've been hooking now probably six or seven years. And I drew this ocean floor up and put the mermaids in. And I wanted to use some different things in it other than wool, so I actually made it very whimsical. I found this nice banana silk in a wool shop, and I bought it. That's what gave me the idea to do mermaids. I said, oh, this color is going to be the blonde, and that'll be the redhead.
Now, do you belong to a club or an organization?
I belong to the White Mountain Woolen Magic.
Tell us a little bit about that.
That's a guild in New Hampshire that you can join, and you can buy rug hooking magazines. They have beautiful patterns and ideas in them. And we meet one Saturday each month, and it's a learning experience. They have different hookers that come and teach you a lot of different techniques.
Can you show us how to do it over here?
Sure. So you get your wool on here taut.
Pull it tight, yeah.
Yep. And I have in my hand one strip, and this is wide cut again.
Okay.
And I'm outlining this horse to give it depth. The background is going to be this chocolate brown. So I'm going to come up here and just put your hook down. Looks like this with that little hook on it.
Yeah, a little hook on the end, yeah.
And I'm going to pull up. I'm holding that wool in my hand and pull up a tail. And just leave about this much on the end.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to go in about every other stitch, pull it up.
And just kind of weave it through, huh?
Yep.
Yeah.
And grab another. But I have to make sure I'm leaving one space, and then the next
for
time,
your other colors,
leave
right?
Two.
Yeah. Appreciate you coming on.
I'm still learning, and I have cards there if any women have been taking them. They're interested in maybe having lessons.
Great.
So.
Great.
I love it. It's relaxing.
Thank you. Now, artists come in different ages here at the art show. And here to join us is Angela. Angela, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about your work here.
So I did a few classes this summer. And so that one, this one, and this one I did in classes. And then a few of my other ones I've just seen things online. Mm-hmm. And I do it with acrylics.
Acrylics, okay. Is it easier to work with acrylic paints?
Yeah.
It is?
Yeah.
So what gave you your inspiration to do this kind of work?
Well, I'm kind of just self-taught. I kind of started when I was 8.
8?
So, yeah.
Uh-huh. So you enjoy it?
Yeah.
Yeah? Great. Well, thanks for showing us all your work. Really appreciate it. Another photographer that we have here is Kutron. Kutron, thanks for coming on the show. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you so much for having us.
Right. Now, you have a lot of photographs here of birds. Is that pretty much your inspiration here with your photographs?
Oh, yeah. I started, I'm a scientist, mm-hmm. molecular immunologist, and I started taking photos for my wife. She's a painter.
Oh.
And for her to paint, but she couldn't keep up with my pace. And that's how okay. That's how I started.
Right.
I started painting, like taking local birds, like blue jays, buntings, and.
What's that picture over there? Can you hold it up and show it to our viewers?
This one?
Yeah.
This is a squirrel, red squirrel, and a hummingbird. Actually,
wow.
It's a photo. I was taking the photo of the squirrel. I didn't see the hummingbird until later on.
So that just came into the picture.
It came
huh?
in the picture. Yes. Yeah.
And
so
you were quick enough to take it, huh?
I didn't see him. Okay. Mm. I didn't even know this was happening until my wife told me afterwards. After she saw the picture, I thought, wow, what
is it? Oh, really? You just thought you, yeah.
That's right.
Wow.
So I called this.
So that happened by accident. Huh?
That's why I named this photo as Close Encounter of the Cute Kind. And
right,
it won
right.
Third place in Chelmsford.
Third place in Chelmsford? Wow.
I'm in Westford, Massachusetts.
Uh-huh.
And others I have buntings, bluebirds, and chickadees and. Titmouse.
Show our viewers the picture back there, the dog.
Yeah, I do commission pet portraits. And people love to have the portrait and put in a frame and take a picture of. And especially the elderly, they have special bond with the pets.
Right.
And some of my friends that saw the photo asked me to do that for them. They suggest me to do that. I said, okay, I'll do that, yeah.
Well, thanks, Kutron. Another photographer that we have here is Franklin. Franklin, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Show us a little bit of your work here.
So most of what I'm showing here are local, so parks and reserves, things like that. I do have a few from, like this one from New York.
Hold it up and show it to our viewers, Franklin.
So this is a picture of raindrops on a window, bus window, uh-huh. in New York City.
Very nice.
It's one of my favorites because it makes you feel like you were there, yeah. like feeling the rain. Yeah.
Yeah. What else you got over here, Frank?
I have this one, which is a snowy night from Boston. I took just this past January.
Beautiful photograph.
It's yeah. I like the black and whites and the contrast
and
the
snow coming down in the lights.
Right.
And, yeah, right. Very nice. What else you got over here?
This one is one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. Well, all the four ones, the ones I'm showing are basically my favorites, but yep. this was the first one of them. And I took this on a cruise looking over the Boston skyline. And I like it so much because it's actually from my iPod, but it's such a good image. People don't even believe that it's from an iPod.
Beautiful photograph.
Yeah.
Very nice. Very nice.
And
what about this one over here, Franklin, the one in the middle?
So this one I like to look at when I'm alone because it's got like a solemn, calm vibe to it.
Yeah, you get the bench over there.
Right, and the trees and the color too. And this is from Benson's Park in Hudson. I took this 2 years ago in winter, but it doesn't look like winter. But yeah, I like it a lot because it's very calm.
So what inspired you about photography, Frankel?
Well, I've always liked photography, and it's...
I know, I can see it on your face.
Right, I always get very excited when I talk about my photographs, but I never thought I could actually take photos until a friend of mine took a photo of my hands, and they were in black and white film, and they were really, really good. So when I saw that, I thought, wow, this could be in a magazine. And I thought, well, then I could do it too. So I took, I was in high school and I took a photo class with Mrs. Freeman, and I loved it. And I got myself a camera. And ever since then, I've been doing it whenever I can. And it's just, it makes me happy taking photos and showing people the product. Because then, like, no one believes that I took this photo, which is even more exciting.
Right. Well, you have great, great work. Keep up the good work, and thanks for being on. Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot. I'm happy to be here, too.
You're welcome. Thank you. We're here with Joan. She's a professional seamstress. Joan, thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much
Tell
for having me.
Tell us a little bit about your work.
Well, I am a professional seamstress.
Okay.
My grandmother started me sewing at the age of 4. She was a tailor in England, wanted to pass her skill on.
All right.
I've been sewing now for over 44 years, and I specialize in wedding dresses and period recreation costuming.
Okay.
This dress I made as a commission by the Historical Society to be worn in the Memorial Day Parade every year. So the gown got originally made, and then the lady wearing it was no longer able. My daughter took it over, but she was taller, so we had to add to the hem and add a cummerbund to take up extra height. And now my granddaughter wears it in the parade.
Yeah, I was just going to ask you where your ideas came from for stuff like this.
My ideas came because I think I was born 200 years too late.
Gotcha.
And all of this just feels like stuff that I can't imagine these ladies wearing 2 layers of skirt and a hoop and a petticoat to work in the fields. So when I do a show like this, I put on a period costume myself to get a feel for what they had to go through. I give sewing lessons. I just moved back into Litchfield a year ago, so I give sewing lessons to men, women, children. Reasonable rate for the lessons. Go ahead.
So what is your inspiration for doing this kind of work?
My inspiration is my grandmother.
Grandmother.
Because she was a professional tailor, and when my daughter was a young girl, my mother was a young girl, she was in theater, and my grandmother made all her costuming for her shows. She did the chorus line. She was known as the songbird in British newspapers. until they immigrated to the United States. So a lot of it comes from her, and because none of this is taught in schools anymore.
Right.
I don't want to take all this knowledge and skill to my grave with me.
You want to share it.
I want to share it to pass it on to a new generation, because everybody has to get dressed. And what we wear doesn't have to come from China.
Right.
It can come from right here in town.
Well, thank you so much for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.
You
Thanks
too.
For coming.
Thank you. Here at the Art Show, we have Christina from Studio Christina's. Thanks for coming on. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank
Tell
you for having us.
Tell us a little bit about your work.
We do water drop photography. We drop waters and we collect, we snap pictures of the collisions and we add paint. Some of them have milk. Some of them we can reflect the picture through the water drop. Everything is unique and different. This one is just an acrylic on a black tile. So this is actually the reflection versus this one with the heart drop that ended up coming out.
So everyone is unique then, huh?
Right, exactly. Uh-huh. Then we have like the American flag that's captured in the drop.
Could you hold that up and show it to our
viewers? Sure, absolutely. The American flag is behind, and the water drop acts like a mirror.
Like a reflection. Right?
Yeah. Oh. So like when you go to the lake and you see the trees.
Very nice.
Yeah.
What do you have over here?
This is just water with some food coloring in it. Okay. And it collects, and it makes, this is like an angel. It looks like an angel.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Very nice.
So right now we're in, this is our first art show, but we're also exhibited over at St. Joe's Hospital for the next 6 months.
Okay.
And we're also in Lawrence Memorial Hospital. We have 20 pieces in each hospital. And we're also the photographers of the 9/11 book from the beam at Benson's Park in Hudson.
Very nice. Thanks, Christina. Thanks for showing our work. Thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, here at the Historical Art Show, we have this beautiful theater curtain, and Steve Koala from the Historical Society is going to talk to us all about it. Steve, go ahead.
Sure. This curtain used to hang in the old Grange Hall in Litchfield, and the Grange Hall stood on land just south of the McQuesten Farm by about a quarter of a mile and on the opposite side of the road. And it burned in 1981, and everyone thought that was the end of the theater curtain, that it had burned and gone. Nobody was ever going to see it again.
Right.
And so many, many years passed, and probably a dozen years or so ago, in the building right next to the Litchfield Historical Society, Barbara Frank's house, which was the old tavern house, there's a huge barn there.
Uh-huh.
And she came over, she saw me at the Historical Society one day and came over and said, gee, do you think there's anything that you'd be interested in buying in my house or barn? And I said, I don't know, I'll have a look. So
yeah.
We went over and
what's in this treasure chest,
yeah,
right?
I looked around the house and out in the barn, we found some treasures. And in the back of the barn, in a corner, was tucked away all of the old tavern furniture, which was just phenomenal to find that.
Right.
And so the Historical Society purchased that, and that was the end of the story for a while. And then about a year later, she came and spoke to me and she said, you know, Stephen, I have cancer and I can't have any more treatment. And I don't know what's going to happen to the property, but I want you to make sure that you've gotten everything you'd like and so forth. So I said, well, let me take another look. So I went back out in the barn and I went up on the lofts this time and everywhere. And
yeah.
I couldn't see anything else except as I was about to leave the barn, I looked up and along the rafters were rolled what I thought were sailboat sails. And I thought, well, you know, the Hendricks who used to live here used to sail, so that's probably what it is, but maybe I better take a look.
Right.
So I got a ladder, went up, got them down, unrolled them, and by God, they were the Grange Hall curtains.
No
one knew still existed. Barbara didn't know.
I would have liked to see your expression when you found that.
Yes. So I quickly went in and talked to Barbara, and we negotiated a price, and I bought them from her.
Yep.
And donated them to the Historical Society, mm-hmm. and there they sat for a number of years. And then a graduate, Dan Ferguson, who graduated in the first class from Campbell High School, was doing a master's thesis in museum studies at the University of New Hampshire. And he approached me and he said, I would like to do a historical research project in Litchfield, if you can think of one for me. And I said, Dan, you've come to the right place.
Right.
I said, we've got this great curtain. We'd love to have it restored. We'd have to get a grant for it. He said, all right, I'll do all the work. And he did. He met with me and he met with Gail Barringer, the vice president of the society. and we did a grant workup together, and he submitted it. He did all the historic research on the artist, on the curtain, and we were approved for a Moose Plate grant. And we next contacted Curtains Without Borders, which is an organization in Vermont that restores these curtains. Okay. And they came over in the dead of winter. It was windy and blowing, and the woman who owns it, Christine Hetzel, said, well, I need to have a look at it. So I said, well, how are we going to unfurl it? She said, well, there's no snow on the ground, so let's roll it out on the lawn. So we went out, and she said, my God, this is the best curtain I've ever seen. But it needs restoration.
Right, right.
So we said, well, we've got the grant. And so she said, fine. We made arrangements. The Litchfield Presbyterian Church let us use their basement one summer. And the women from Vermont came down. There were about half a dozen of them. And they worked on the curtain for several weeks. Denise Freeman and Heidi Miller from the school arts instructors came in. They brought students with them. They worked on the curtain. We had volunteers from the Historical Society. It was all done. And then in the fall of 2013, we unveiled the curtain for the first time in many years at a dedication ceremony at Campbell High School. And it has been put, after we do these ceremonies, we roll the curtains back up and we store them away in the Historical Society building. And Chuck Moore, who teaches at the high school in the, I don't think he's in the arts department, but he's home building and crafts and that sort of thing. He built these holders for the curtains.
Hold it up, yeah.
Yeah. And he donated all of that to us. Yeah. And
let's take a step back here, Steve, so our viewers at home could see this. So this has been touched up, so
this has been professionally restored. And you know, it's an interesting process. We documented with photographs the whole process, and they come in with little tiny brushes, and they clean the whole surface because it hadn't been cleaned in years and years and years, and just grime and dust and dirt gets on it, and they get all that off, and then they vacuum the surface, and then they go back through, and any place that's missing huge amounts of paint, they do some in painting. They had to do some in painting in the corner of the draperies because you can see where they're worn, but they only do as much as they have to,
right,
and try to leave it as intact and original as possible.
Uh-huh.
And a couple of years ago, Christine Hetzel, who owns the Curtains Without Borders company, published a book, and it's called Suspended Worlds, and lo and behold, featured in it is our curtain. And so we are very, very lucky. And featured in the center of this is Chief Passaconaway.
Okay.
And Chief Passaconaway was a very interesting character. He was friendly to the white people when they came to settle the country. It is said that he was present at Plymouth Rock. And he lived, he summered here in Litchfield.
Is that right?
Yes. And as white settlers came in, he was very distressed because his beautiful little town was having settlers and it wasn't his land to use anymore. So he petitioned the royal governor of Massachusetts, and he was granted 3 square miles of land in Litchfield. And it starts where Hillcrest Road is today, and it runs up to the end of town. And in the middle of the river there are 2 islands, and they're called Reed's Islands for the Reed family. And those are the islands that Chief Passaconaway loved. And he summered on those islands. And so that's what he was given the right to do. And he continued to do that for the rest of his life. There's a lot of speculation as to where he's buried. He may be buried on one of those islands. Some people think he's buried on the riverbank in Bedford. And we're not quite sure. But he was very peaceful and helpful to the white settlers who came to Litchfield.
Okay, now there's another side to this curtain, and Steve's going to talk to us about this side.
This is an advertising curtain, and this was used as a backdrop for productions at the Grange Hall, so that when a show was done or some other affair was going on and someone contributed a little bit of money to get the show going and they wanted some advertisement for it, this is how they were paid back. They'd have a little square put on the curtain so people could see who'd contributed. And there were a lot of local businesses on this. This was probably painted in the 1920s. And there's still a lot of business around because here we can see Farwell Funeral Home. They're still going. Okay. McQuesten and Lewis was a grocery store in Manchester.
Grocery store?
Eugene McQuesten operated a car dealership in Nashville. These were all Litchfield natives.
Right.
And Miller's Women's Shop was on Main Street in Nashua. On the other side, we've got Broadview Farm, which was Dave Campbell, the old police chief's farm in Litchfield. And we have Davis Funeral Home. We have Johnson's Electric in Nashua, and they were Litchfield folks. Hool's Beauty School, my mother was a graduate there. Mm-hmm. And this is an advertising curtain.
Now, how much did basically it cost to have something like this put on a curtain, Steve?
It was probably pretty inexpensive. Probably just a few dollars would have bought you a spot on the curtain. I will bet less than $5.
Which was a lot of money at that time.
A lot of money in those days, but people were, they'd make their own costumes. They didn't have to buy much. Yep. Everyone was pretty good at putting a show together.
Yeah. Well, thanks for showing us, Steve. This is really a beautiful curtain. I hope generations to come will admire it as much as we do right here. Thank you.
Well, thank you, John. The Historical Society would really like to thank you for coming and interviewing all of the artists at this art show, and we think it's a wonderful event that we hope we can do more frequently in Litchfield.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That brings us to the end of the art show here at Griffin Memorial School in Litchfield. I'm John Latcher from my cameraman, Anthony DiMambro. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time, everybody. Bye-bye.
The preceding program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.